بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة على رسول الله. Respected Sheikh and Imam, our scholars of Islam, my brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. All praises due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Choices, peace, blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his companions and his family and all those who strive to emulate his lifestyle till the end of time. Alhamdulillah, shukran for the very beautiful introduction. I appreciate from my namesake, Sheikh Muhammad Falanda. And Falanda, I think, is Greek. It means phil, which means friend, and andro, which means man, friend of man. So alhamdulillah, I think Maulana is a very, very friendly character. And you are all men, so alhamdulillah, in the best sense of the word, inshallah. I've been given the task this evening to talk to you about khilafah, the definition of it, the types of khilafah, and the future of khilafah. When Sheikh Muhammad called me and he asked me if I would be interested in doing this topic, I must say, I told him it's a very challenging topic, to be honest. And he basically said, we have the same surname, so you have to come speak. I hope I will do justice to the topic. That was 2 weeks ago, and since then, I've been frantically reading and trying to put together something that is going to give an understanding of Khilafah in a very short space of time. I don't consider this a khutbah, by the way. You see a khutbah, right? I consider this a class. I consider this a class. I see myself as a teacher that has been given a topic that he had to research and that he had to teach. And I consider you then, therefore, like myself, who is a student of Islam, I consider you all to be then students of Islam, sitting here with an open mind, willing to learn and willing to take in, inshallah ta'ala, the good of whatever I have to say, inshallah. So, let's dive into this topic immediately. The methodology. What's my methodology going to be? I'm going to start by giving you a definition of the word, or maybe multiple definitions. If you want to jot down questions, by the way, and you can't jot it down because you don't have a pen, you can jot it down on your cell phone, as long as you're not chatting. Because people are all tech savvy, and then maybe you can just remember it and hand it and for later. So I will be giving you a definition or a couple of definitions to broaden the understanding. In that definition, I will make reference to a few verses from the Quran. After that, I will proceed to give an understanding of Khilafah. We need to take a look at history, and we need to have an understanding of what form this concept of Khilafah took in the imagination of the people living in that time, the time of the companions, and after their time. It's important for us to have an historical understanding of the term Khilafah. And when I get to that point, inshallah ta'ala, we will see how much time we have left, and then I will proceed. There's a number of clarifications I must make before I start. The other thing is that I'm going to be referring to the Khulafa a lot. So I'm going to be speaking a lot about Abu Bakr, about Umar, about Uthman and Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een. And I might not say radiallahu an every time, okay? Because I'm going to be repeating their names so often. It is not out of disrespect that I'm going to be doing that. I will say it in between, but just as a matter of not every time having to say radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Sometimes it comes in, so please accept this already as a disclaimer, yeah? That in no way is it disrespect when I don't say radiallahu anhu. It is just sometimes in the flow of the talk, sometimes it is easier just to say Ali and then go on, because I'm going to have to mention his name maybe 10 more times after that. So I have started by stating we are going to speak about the Khulafa Rashidin radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, from the very beginning. And then to start off, maybe, would be to set the record straight. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets the record straight in the Quran when he says, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim, والسابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار والذين اتبعوهم بإحسان رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عن. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, and the foremost, meaning the foremost, the sabiqun, those who were first, in inverted commas, to embrace Islam, are the muhajirun and the ansar. Those were the ones, اتبعوهم بإحسان, they followed, and those who followed them, and those who followed them, بإحسان. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is well pleased with them, as they are well pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we speak about the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, this is the type of reverence we have. The type of reverence that we have at all times is radiallahu anhum wa radu'an. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them, and they are pleased with him. Okay, so it's important for us to just set some rules with regard to that. So I hope you understand the reasons for that, inshallah. Okay, the word khilafah, or the word khalifa. The first time I heard this word khalifa was when I was in madrasa. To take a khalifa. Right? To take a khalifa. And basically then a khalifa was a teacher. He was basically my madrasa teacher. We used to call him a khalifa. This is not what we are going to be talking about today. The word khalifa means literally to succeed. Not in the meaning of being successful, rather in the meaning of coming after. One who comes after, or one who comes as a replacement. In English, for example, the prince succeeded the king to the throne. So it can be said in Arabic, for example, Khalafa Zayd Amran fi hadha al-amr, that Zayd, he succeeded Amr in this matter, whatever the matter is. We say this when a person, when Zayd is taking the position of Amr in a particular matter. The first time we come across the word in the Quran, when we read the Quran, the word Khalifa. Khilafa, by the way, is a variant of the word Khalifa. We will go into that a little bit later. Then Khalifa is used in the Quran when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to the malaika and informs the angels, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةٌ. And recall, your Lord, he said to the angels, Verily I will place in the earth, I will place in the land a Khalifa. It comes in Surah Yunus as well, in verse 13, the plural of the word Khalifa. ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ خَلَائِفَ الْأَرْضِ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ لِنَنْظُرَ كَيْفَ تَعْمَلُونَ. Is that correct? ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ خَلَائِفَ فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ لِنَنْظُرَ كَيْفَ تَعْمَلُونَ. Then we made you successors, or we made you inheritors in the land after them, in order that we see how you will perform. So this is how the word appears in the Quran. With regard to that first verse, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the angels, I will be placing on earth a khalifa, then what does this mean exactly in the context of the verse? The word khalifa is also translated as vicegerent. And a vicegerent is a person exercising delegated power. It is seen, a person who is seen to be an earthly representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we are speaking, when we are understanding the word khalifa in the terms of vicegerent, in terms of an earthly representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a person exercising delegated power conferred to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we can only possibly be speaking about a Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses these special persons They are anbiya and they are rusul. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspires them, reveals to them via a process of wahi. Certain from amongst them are called anbiya, from the word naba, to inform. They are informed about something and they will inform others. Others are called rusul. They are messengers. Not only were they inspired divinely, but they were also given a scripture from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is with this divine inspiration and it is with the scripture that they receive from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they have this vested divine authority to be able to lead mankind. And when we talk about lead mankind, we talk about leading mankind in a moral sense, in a political sense. We're talking about the word lead in a very, very broad sense of leading. So some of the ulama, they say this ayah, it has the meaning of vicegerent and it refers to Adam alayhi salatu wassalam. If we take the report of Ibn Abbas in the Mustadrak of Hakim, it's also found in the tafsir of Tabari, then we find that it is used, the meaning is used when of Khalifa, that the earth was first populated with jinn kind. This is according to the report of Ibn Abbas in the Mustadrak of Hakim. They were the first to populate the earth. So then the word successor would make sense. Then the word successor or inheritor or replacement would make sense. Because then Adam alayhi salatu wassalam, he was then created as the successor to the jinn kind. No longer were they the inheritors of the earth. No longer were they entrusted with responsibility to guide and guide others. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created another creation, insan, man. And so Adam and Adam's progeny, those who come after him, his children, and then their children, they would succeed one another as khulafa, which is the plural of khalifa. They would succeed one another as representatives. And then still we got the meaning of they would then enact the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hassan al-Basri's view of the meaning of this verse is that khilafah refers to the children of Adam. To the children of Adam alayhi salatu wassalam. So one generation, khalifah is referring to one generation succeeding another generation. So the children succeeding their father and so on and so forth. And it is this meaning of succession, man succeeding another man in relation to leadership. It is this meaning that becomes important for us this evening. And this is the implied meaning to a ruler when he is called the Khalifa. Since the ruler, he replaces the one who came before him. And not only does he replace the one who comes before him, but he also inherits the responsibility of the one who came before him. It's one thing to just inherit the position. It's a completely other thing to inherit the responsibility that the position brings as well. Khalifa refers to both. You inherit the position and you inherit the responsibility that comes with the position. What is the position and what is the responsibility that comes with the position? I hope this serves as a base for us, inshallah ta'ala. This definition serves as a base for us to move forward from, inshallah. So what is, where do we go from here? The responsibility then, of all the anbiya, if you want to succeed someone and you want to know what to do, you must know who you are succeeding and you must know what the responsibility was of the person you are succeeding. So the first successors, namely Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, they were the successors of whom? Abu Bakr was whose successor? He was the successor of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So let's first just pause here. And let's look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The responsibility of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are all the same. If you want to refine it, and if you want to look for one meaning, then there's a beautiful verse that comes numerous times in the Quran that refers to the response of many of the anbiya, or the call of many anbiya. It was, Ya qawmi abudullah. O my people, worship Allah. مَا لَكُم مِّنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرُهُ There is not for you a God beside Him. This verse comes repeatedly in the Quran after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the names of various anbiya and with regard to what their mission is. Then their mission is, Ya qawmi abudullah, O my people, worship Allah, ma lakum min ilahin ghayru, there is no God beside Him. So this is in a nutshell the mission of all the anbiya. The mission of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the same. It was to call man towards knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ Know and understand that there is no God except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was calling man towards recognizing the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was calling man to be dutiful towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet would also teach morality, which seeks to develop man into a morally sound being, a being that does عَمَلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ A being that does good, pious deeds. This was the work of the Anbiya. It was a case of calling towards sound belief and sound action in this world so that you may reap the reward in the year after. The year after was a very dominant part of the call of the Anbiya. The temporary nature of this world and the permanence and the everlasting nature of the year after. It didn't matter whether the Prophet was a king like in the case of Nabi Sulaiman or whether the Prophet was an ordinary shepherd as was the case of most of the Anbiya. Their responsibility was the same. The call was also the same. The Quran is filled with narratives about the lives of some of these Prophets and the challenges they underwent at the hands of those who rejected them. Anbiya was rejected. Yes, we know that. We know that that is how kufr basically exists. Kufr exists because there's a call to truth and there's a rejection of that truth. There's a call to truth from a truthful claimant, a prophet of Allah, and then there's a rejection of that and then that becomes kufr. So prophets were rejected and you know history bears testimony to the fact that prophets were killed, anbiya were killed. The Quran speaks about that. And we know of the nation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses as an example with regard to killing of the anbiya. About Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Quran states, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ We did not but send you, O Muhammad, as a mercy unto all of mankind, all of humanity. His action, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bears testimony that he was much more concerned or he was as concerned for the worldly well-being of his followers as he was concerned for their well-being in the year after. Islam is like this. The nature of Islam is that it cares for people in the dunya and it cares for them and their condition in the year after. It deals with human beings as if they are living in this world. It doesn't deal with human beings like they are living in the year after. When we are alive and well, there's many calls in the Quran for us to act in a manner that will result in a good dunya life. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ Successful are the believers, those who are humble in their salah. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ And then you find those who are turning away from laghu. Those are turning away from disdainful or nonsense talk. See, first Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about salah, your connection with Allah. Then suddenly He speaks about how you should live. The Quran is replete with examples like this. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ The successful believers are the ones who protect their chastity in this world. So the Prophet is as much interested in how you live a morally upright life here as he's interested in for you to attain Jannah. The Quran is replete with examples. We find in the various surah, the short surah of the Quran, we are encouraged with regard to the orphan. We are encouraged not to turn away from the orphan. We are encouraged to feed the orphan. We are encouraged not to turn away the one who asks. We are encouraged to feed the one and give the one who asks. Subhanallah. So there is many examples in the Quran that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam had taught that calls us to a good worldly life. that wants to establish a good moral code for insan. Then over and above that, history also attests to the fact that sanctuary or safety for the believers was of paramount importance. The Prophet ﷺ made political decisions as well. One of the first political decisions the Prophet ﷺ made was to send the Muslims who were being persecuted in Makkah al-Mukarramah, was to send them on the first hijrah to Abyssinia. This was one of the first political, we can call it political, decisions that the Prophet ﷺ had made. The second one was the hijrah to Madinah al-Munawwara, which was the main hijrah, which resulted in the establishment of a fledgling community, which eventually resulted in a fledgling state. So the Prophet ﷺ, he did not only call people to Islam and then leave them, and then they had to sort themselves out. Now that you believe in Allah, okay, sort your own dunya out. It wasn't like that. Now that you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we as a community, we are going to sort ourselves out. We are going to sort out our iman, we are going to entrench ourselves in Islam, and we are going to work towards our safety, our sanctuary, in a way that will allow us to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way He should be worshipped. So, leadership in its entirety, connecting people to Allah and administering their worldly affairs, it rested with the Prophet. Now, if that is what anbiya do, can you imagine how difficult it is to succeed a Nabi? Can an ordinary human being really succeed a Nabi? Can an ordinary human being really have that level of everything that a Nabi has? Hilm, sabr, forward thinking, everything. And then the Nabi is also receiving wahi and communicating with Allah at the same time, practicing exceptional human qualities. Now suddenly we see how difficult this notion is of being a khalifa to the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is. It's mind-boggling just how a difficult task this is. And it was only after the demise of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the question of succession became real. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had died. The ummah is no longer has a Nabi. They no longer have a connection with wahi. In قَطَعَتِ الْوَحِي مِنَ السَّمَاءِ, the wahi had now been cut off from the heavens due to the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the ummah is at a loss for leadership. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he had been appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as is the case of anbiya. An ordinary man, on the other hand, cannot claim leadership by divine right. An ordinary man cannot do that. He cannot say, Allah chose me, I'm leading you because Allah chose me. Because then any Tom, Dick and Harry can get up and claim that Allah chose him. And then another one can get up, or rather Dick can get up, then Tom can get up, and then Harry can get up. And all of them can lay claim that they were chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not how it works with regard to ordinary man. A successor to the Prophet would not be succeeding him also in his role as the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's not going to inherit wahi. He's not going to inherit nubuwa. No. Rather, he's going to be a custodian of the teachings of that Prophet, especially with regard to belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and doing good deeds. So the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were well aware of this, that with the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, revelation would cease and they would have the responsibility to convey, and they would have the responsibility to implement. Okay, so now at this point, now we're at the critical point of this talk. So my talk is not to tell you about the lives of these great illustrious Sahaba. The speakers are going to come, inshallah, next week and the week after that. The speakers are going to come and they're going to give you detailed descriptions of the lives of these great men. I'm going to be focusing on the process of electing a Khalifa. So there was a process, there was something that happened that brought these men into power. This part of my talk, I'm going to be focusing on those processes. We cannot have an appreciation for the term Khalifa for the concept Khalifa if we don't understand how power becomes vested in a person who is called a Khalifa. So while many narrations have surfaced, let's start with Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. While many narrations have surfaced suggesting Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to be the successor, the companions were under no strict definitive instruction to appoint him. They were under no strict definitive instruction to appoint him. If they were under strict definitive instruction to appoint him, they would have appointed him immediately after the demise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There was ishara, yes. There was an indication. There was indication in the life of the Prophet and there was an indication in the sayings of the Prophet. The matter was put to consultation. It was put to a consultation process. And yeah, up until, you must understand, this is extremely significant. We're going to talk about this blasé. Okay, let mashura khamak. But you have to understand that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he was born into a tribal community. He was born into a community where there were a few settlements. Mecca, Yathrib, few settlements. Then also, largely the Arabs were Bedouins. And they were moving around. And it was the nature of the Bedouin that he lives in a tent with his family. And his extended family is living in the tents around him. So the family forms a clan, a number of tents. And then the clan in turn forms a tribe. And then that tribe is an independent world to itself. That tribe is a law unto itself. That tribe has a code of honor that it works by. This was the community. And Arabia was made up of hundreds of these types of tribes. It was into such a society that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born. Can you imagine the work that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam had to do? Because the same type of power structures existed in Makkatul Mukarramah. Various tribes exercising various levels of authority because they are a particular tribe. Here the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam comes around and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he unites and he galvanizes, he seeks to unite them, he seeks to galvanize all these different tribes under a single banner. And the banner is that of La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is his work. This is his mission. Can you imagine the enormity of this? The enormity of this. When it baffles, once again, it baffles the mind. How is this even going to be possible? That one man can galvanize an entire Arabian peninsula that is completely fragmented by nature. There's nothing wrong with tribal systems. It's something that comes along. Our man has evolved. There's nothing wrong with it. But for them to just relinquish it, to relinquish the authority that they had, to rewrite their codes, to rewrite what it meant to be honorable. And the Quran came to teach them because they wanted to immortalize themselves in different ways. One of the ways that they wanted to immortalize themselves was they wanted to be very generous. But they didn't want to be generous for the sake of generosity. They wanted to be generous so that they could be immortal. So that his name and his family name can live on long after he had died. Because he was so and so, he was very generous. So and so was extremely brave. Then the Quran came to teach, Ya ayyuhan nasu inna khalaqnakum min dhakari wa untha. O mankind, we created you from a single male and female. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلٍ. We made you into clans and we made you into tribes. شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلًا لِتَعَارَفُوا. For the reason that you might recognize one another. Know that this one and this is this one. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ. But the most noble of you is not the most generous of you. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. The most noble of you in the sight of Allah. أَتْقَاكُمْ. Is those who have the most taqwa. This is the leveler the Quran comes and it becomes the leveler. No tribe can outstrip another tribe. The only way you can outstrip another human being is in taqwa. And where is taqwa? Taqwa is between you and between your creator. At-taqwa ha-huna. Taqwa is here. It's not something that human beings can measure. It is something that only Allah can measure. Isn't that the ultimate leveler? Everyone immediately is equal. Subhanallah. Then Allah reminds also, wa'tasimu bihablillah. Hold on firmly, all of you, to the rope of Allah. Jami'a, all of you, wa la tafarraqu. Don't be disunited. You have this tribe, that tribe, this tribe, that tribe, this, the politics. All of you hold firmly to the rope of Allah. Don't be disunited. Wa la tafarraqu. Wadhkuru. And remember, ni'mat Allahi alaykum. Remember the favor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala done to you. إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً. When you, all you tribes, you were all enemies fighting with one another. Petty squabbles. And your petty squabbles turned into murderous pillaging and killing of one another. Subhanallah. You were enemies. أَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ. So He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, united between your hearts. Subhanallah. The Quran was the remedy. The Quran was the remedy. Now, and this was the work of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he struggled. It was an uphill battle all the time, even in Madinatul Munawwar. Sometimes the Muslims would interact with one another, but they would interact and say things to one another on a tribal basis. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam would remind them, are you acting out the acts of Jahiliyyah? The remnants of Jahiliyyah is in you. You're referring to those things that we had left behind. You want to still act it out now? It was uphill battle constantly, constantly. Now imagine, so Abu Bakr radiallahu an is then going to be the first person after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Arabian Peninsula to do what? To lead the Muslim ummah as an ummah. He's not leading as a tribal leader. He's leading as a genuine leader, successor to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How was he elected? The matter was put to consultation. While there was this unity, but there was also an understanding that in Madinatul Munawwara there was the Muhajirun and the Ansar. This is an accepted fact. There was the Mu'akhad initially that existed between them, the ties of brotherhood that the Prophet had instituted. And at the same time, the Muhajirun, at the same time they were thinking about this topic of successor to the Prophet, the Ansar were thinking about it as well. But they were thinking about it in separate quarters. The Muhajirun came to hear about this. They came together in a single place, and then the Ansar had already put up a candidate. And then it ended where Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was also put up as a candidate, and everyone accepted. The candidate of the Ansar stood down, and all the Ansar and the Muhajirun collectively, they saw allegiance to Abu Bakr radiallahu an as the first Khalifa of Islam. And this is significant. All the companions, without exception, they saw obedience and allegiance to him. The companions managed to overcome a number of challenges, and it's important to remember this as well. One of the challenges that they overcame there, it might seem like a small thing that they did, it was huge. There was no clear directives in terms of succession. That was one of the challenges. If there was just a clear ayah to tell them, okay, do this, then they could have just done it. But there was no clear cut directives in terms of succession. So the companions, they managed to overcome this through a process of electoral consultation. They did this themselves. We are going to consult one another on this matter. And we are going to put forward considerations on who should be the Khalifa and why. And this is what they did. Brilliant. The second challenge that they overcame, the potential was real for division to creep in via the election process. The Ansar could easily have said, no, no, our candidate, we're not letting him stand down. We're pushing for our candidate, isn't it? They could have done that. No, it didn't happen. They averted division by agreeing on the candidate Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and collectively swearing allegiance to him. What comes through here? The unity of the Ummah. At that stage, it was understood by all to be important. Everyone understood the value of unity. Three, accountability. Who was the Khalifa going to be accountable to? The Prophet was accountable to Allah. That wasn't a problem too. Because in the case of the successor, I mean Abu Bakr, in his inaugural address, he made it clear that he was not a ruler that was above the law, and that he was equally responsible to adhere to the Quran and the Sunnah. He held that to tell the truth to a person commissioned to rule was faithful allegiance. You had to be truthful to the Amir, then you were faithful. And to conceal the truth from the Amir, even if he's wrong, was treason. So you had to tell him the truth no matter what. His leadership lent itself to be audited. It lent itself, you could check the Amir. How? You could check the Amir to the standards of the Quran and the Sunnah. The fourth challenge that they overcome was tribal and familial succession. It wasn't a tribe that succeeded. They did say, yeah, we need to put a candidate from the Quraysh forward in the form of Abu Bakr because the Quraysh enjoys a certain amount of prestige and authority that would make it easier on Islam and Muslims. So they saw the benefits of having a Qurayshi. But leadership wasn't necessarily based on the fact that he had to be a Qurayshi. It wasn't like that. Or family. It wasn't necessarily based on the fact that no, we have to choose a family member of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There was nothing like that. They overcame this. The Khalifa would represent the interest of the Muslim Ummah and not represent the interest of a tribe or a family. He would represent the interest of the entire Ummah. This did not mean that Islam done away with the old tribal regimes. The old tribal regimes were still there. Tribalism was there very long. Tribalism is still in the Hijaz area. Okay. Can I take some water? History is boring. I hope you don't fall asleep. Don't fall asleep, inshallah ta'ala. If you fall asleep, change position or stretch. It's alright to sit in the masjid. Light stretch a bit. Check out, you know. Go for a walk. Don't walk, it's disturbing. Umar. Okay, Umar. So that's how Abu Bakr came into power. Umar radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr on his deathbed, at the request of his fellow companions, for him to choose a successor, nominated Umar. Abu Bakr is on his deathbed. His companions tell him, the close companions tell him, oh Abu Bakr, you nominate a leader for us, a successor. And he nominates Umar. And this nomination of Abu Bakr goes unchallenged. And Umar became the first Khalifa to be appointed by his predecessor. But his predecessor didn't unilaterally appoint him. How did his predecessor appoint him? His predecessor appointed him with rights that were vested in him by the companions. We can choose. We chose earlier on. We chose you. Isn't it? We came together and we chose you. We were happy with you. Now we want you to choose for us. Beautiful. Beautiful. And he chooses for them. And he chooses Umar radiallahu anhu. And everyone is happy that he chose Umar radiallahu anhu, except there's one riwaya of a person who was a bit unhappy because he said Umar was a bit strict. So, right. But 99.9% is extremely happy And the guy who said he was strict wasn't unhappy. He just said, he's strict. He didn't say, I don't want to accept him. He just said, he's strict, eh? Remember. That's all. Abu Bakr, through this process of allowing, or through the process of allowing Mashura on the matter, showed that the matter of leadership or successorship or khilafah or rule is one that involved the community. The companions were involved in the election of Abu Bakr. The companions were once again involved in the nomination of Umar radiallahu anhu. Islam flourished. The person who's going to deal with this is going to tell you the details. The Muslim territory expanded under Umar through conquest. And Umar was the first of the Khulafa to be called Amirul Mu'mineen. Then this title was conferred on him. Yeah, I want to stop. And I spoke about Abu Bakr and Umar. But what makes the Khilafah of Abu Bakr and Umar a Khilafah, as the heading of this course states, ala sunnati Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? A notable characteristic of the Khilafah of Umar, a notable characteristic, was his concern that anyone connected to the functioning of the state should be careful not to become entrapped by worldly trappings. He had this concern for the entire ummah. Don't become entrapped in this dunya. This dunya is ghurur. But especially if you are a functionary of the state, then don't become entrapped in the dunya. An example of this is the garrison towns. He set up garrison towns. After they conquered a certain area, he didn't allow the soldiers to go into the area and set up camp in the area. They had to set up camp outside of the area. And they had to have a functioning town there, all by themselves. He didn't want them to live in a town where the love of the dunya was going to go into their hearts. And they were going to forget what they were serving. They were serving a state. A state that was doing what? A state that was looking in the interest of the citizens for their dunya and for their akhirah. So he had an acute understanding of this. Another thing that he did was he limited the booty. He limited the booty. Why did he limit the booty? He placed a restriction on the booty that soldiers could receive, thereby preventing state-sponsored wealthy class. We know about the state-sponsored wealthy class. No? We live in South Africa, yeah. Yeah, there is a state-sponsored wealthy class here. Entrepreneurs and mutiprati. Right? So he wanted to prevent that. There was going to be no state-sponsored wealthy class under Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar himself led a simple lifestyle that showed no evidence that he was the Khalifa of the Islamic Empire. The famous incident when he came to Jerusalem, when they came to give him the keys of Aqsa, of the city. That's the classic example. Everyone was waiting for him to arrive. And he came and he was pulling the donkey and his slave was sitting on top of the donkey. And one of the first, his first order of business was, when he finally got to the ceremony, his first order of business was that he looked at his fellow generals, and he commented about the smart clothing that they were wearing. You just took over now, Kekulekela. This was Umar radiallahu anhu. This was his concern was always, you just took over and you saw cutting yourselves new clothes. Dunya. He was constantly reminding of them. This is the function of a Khalifa. Because this is a function of a prophet. The function of the prophet is to remind people consistently that you are a human being with a ruh that will be held accountable by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umar did an extremely good job in this. Umar was an extraordinary genius in terms of his ability to lead the ummah. And we must say that Umar was an extraordinary leader. Abu Bakr was an extraordinary leader. Their immediate companions also understood and supported their leadership. They had companions around them who were nurtured under the guidance of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So their companions had an acute understanding of what their responsibility was. And they wanted to support them in their responsibility. Because they understood that this isn't a luxury position. This is a burden. To be a khalifa is a burden. Because you are accountable. And you have to lead with taqwa. Subhanallah. So they had excellent supporters. They had excellent supporters. In fact, it brings to mind one day Ali radiallahu anhu. And we will come to that. In the time of Ali radiallahu anhu, everything was haywire. It wasn't simple anymore. Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhu, yeah, simple. Things become complicated now as we're going to progress. And in these complications in the Khalifa of Ali, a person gets up and tells him, why is it that now in your Khalifa we are going through all this difficulty? In the time of your predecessors, it wasn't like this. In the time of Abu Bakr and Umar, it wasn't like this. Why now in your time are we experiencing all this turmoil? So Ali radiallahu anhu told him, because Abu Bakr and Umar, they had followers like me. And I have followers like you. You see? Yeah. That basically sums up also what I'm trying to say here. That while Abu Bakr and Umar were extraordinary in their leadership, they had extraordinary followers and supporters. Extraordinary followers and supporters. But the Ummah was expanding. The Ummah was growing. Islam was no longer Makkah, Medina. Islam became an empire. Iraq gets taken. Syria gets taken. Egypt gets taken. Jerusalem gets taken. It's an empire. We are impressed with Mandela. And Mandela took nothing. He was given the country. Here we find a person in the form of Umar radiallahu anhu. Look at his genius and we are not in awe. We are not putting his quotable quotes on our profiles. We should do his quotable quotes on our profiles, subhanAllah. He is really worth mentioning. So, what happened? Another thing that was outstanding of these two khulafa is that they took the initiative to ensure that there's a smooth transition of power. Abu Bakr, he took the initiative while he was living on his deathbed to ensure that there was a transition of power and a smooth transition. Umar did the same thing. Umar did the same thing. Umar's Khilafah lasted for 10 years. On Umar's deathbed, he nominated a committee of six distinguished companions of the Prophet. All from amongst the Ashar al-Mubashara. Those 10 companions who were given the glad tidings of paradise in their lifetime. 6 was chosen. Zubayr ibn al-Awam, Sa'd ibn Waqas, Abdurrahman ibn Awf, Talha ibn Ubaidullah, Ali ibn Abi Talib, and Uthman ibn Affan. They get appointed. Umar appoints them. And then Umar appoints his son, Abdullah ibn Umar, as a moderator. You the moderator. They have to decide, and you are the moderator. So Abdullah ibn Umar doesn't get an opportunity even to be considered. The decision for Khilafah must come, or the next Khalif will come from one of these 6 men. But my son is excluded. But you have the job that if there's a tie in the vote, then you have the job that you have a casting vote. You have a casting vote. He didn't need to exercise his casting vote. There was no tie. And it was through this process that Uthman radiallahu anh was proclaimed the Khalifa. Look at the foresight of who? Of Umar radiallahu anh. Smooth transition of power. Uthman's Khalifa lasted for 12 years. During the first 8 years, everything was going well. After that, there was some discontent. The scope of this talk doesn't allow us to go into the details. Right? Suffice it to say that complaints were being leveled against the Khalifa. Complaints were being leveled against him. Some of it warranted. Some of it unwarranted. Remember, the empire was expanding. So if we're talking about complaints now, we're talking about an empire. So there's bound to be some complaints, isn't it? There's bound to be some complaints. But what happened was, this eventually mushroomed into a revolt. This is the nature of insan. The nature of insan is that they become agitated because they want the result now. So they become agitators and then they become agitators. And this is what happened. The protesters, the long and the short of the story, go read the history inshallah ta'ala. The protesters, they swarmed to Medina, which was the seat of Khilafah. They swarmed to Medina and they laid siege to the house of Uthman. Now you might be thinking, but Uthman is the Khalifa. How can they lay siege? He's the Khalifa, yes, but Medina isn't a town full of armed forces. The forces are in Syria, in Iraq. The forces are positioned strategically, not necessarily at the core. So they lay siege to the house of Uthman. While Uthman, he is still the undisputed Khilafa. He could easily have summoned the forces, but he didn't do this. This could be for two reasons. Firstly, he didn't want to be, we can speculate, he didn't want to be the first Khalifa that was going to shed Muslim blood, to raise a Muslim army against Muslim citizens. He didn't want the first to be there, to do that. There is riwayat in this regard that actually attests that he actually said something to this effect. That Abu Bakr hadn't done it, Umar hadn't done it, he was not going to be the one that was going to start it. That could be one reason. The other reason was that the forces in Syria is far away. The time it takes for them to come to Medina, and the agitators knew that if they were going to protract the siege up until the Hajj period, then the people would come from the Hajj and they might march onto Medina to support their Khalif Uthman. They knew this. To cut a long story short, despite efforts by Ali ibn Abi Talib, despite efforts by Muhammad ibn Maslama to quell the protest and to quell the revolt, there was an escalation in the revolt, which eventually resulted in the most tragic end. And the tragic end was that in Madinatul Munawwara, the Khalif Uthman was killed in his own home. And along with Uthman radiallahu anhu, died the unity of the Muslims. And if you're feeling it, then I feel it with you. This incident raised questions, even that time, for the Muslims, such as, what is the relationship between the Muslims and the state? What do you do if you got concerns? How is concerns raised? And also, what is the religious position towards rebellion against legitimate rule? What should you do if there's a rebellion against legitimate rule? These are some of the questions that the fuqaha have tackled. It was in this environment that Ali radiallahu an found himself. The dynamics of the Muslim community was now very different from the time of Abu Bakr. It was very different from when the time of Umar took power. It was very different from initially the time of Uthman when he took power. Ali radiallahu an is in an environment where the dynamics is completely different. The revolt against Uthman and that ended in the killing of Uthman, it polarized the community. It split the community into two. The authority of the state also was slowly deteriorating already, until eventually now with the assassination of Uthman, the authority of the state was completely undermined. The machinery of law and order had virtually broken down. People now only started to realize the gravity of what had happened. And they were only now starting to think of the likely repercussions of what had happened. And the Islamic Empire consisted of many regions, and all were affected by the killing of Uthman. And all of these regions with their governors were struggling to come to terms with the implications of what had happened in Medina. It was a low point. It was a low point. Do you feel it for Ali? Do you want to be the person who is now elected as the Khalifa and come into this type of an environment where the Ummah is split in two, not only in Medina, it is split in two throughout the empire? Is this the environment you want to take leadership of? I firstly want you to get an appreciation for the difficulty of the task that lay ahead for Ali radiallahu anhu. I want you to appreciate that first. Ali was always going to be the natural successor. The companions knew that in fact with the voting of Uthman in, he would have been, he had second most votes. So it was almost a foregone conclusion that the next Khalif would be Ali radiallahu anhu. But now the circumstances that Ali radiallahu anhu comes into power, Ali is now finally urged by his fellow companions of the Prophet to succeed Uthman as Khalifa. They told him, you have to take this position. There's a void. In a public gathering, Ali announces his candidacy. And people start swearing the oath of allegiance to him, including the senior companions, Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, Ibn Umar, Usama ibn Zayd, Amr, and others. The rebels at this point, they hardly appear in the discussion. If you look in history, when they talk about how Ali radiallahu anhu came into power, the rebels, they're not part of the discussion. Ali had no need to enlist supporters to help him gain the position of Khilafah. In fact, he didn't want it. So he wasn't in the business of looking for supporters. So he was a reluctant candidate, like his predecessors. They were reluctant candidates. So the rebels, when the rebels supported Ali radiallahu anhu in his Khilafah, this was a complication that he could do without, isn't it? Everyone knew that Ali radiallahu anhu must be the Khalifa. And they supported him. But when the rebels support you, doesn't that further complicate the matter? Can you appreciate where we're going with this? Subhanallah. So Ali's succession to the position of Khilafah is uncontested. Uncontested. Everyone agrees. But it's not just about agreement. It is about what the work that lay ahead. The opposition he would face later from Talha ibn Abdullah and Zubayr ibn al-Awam, and also from the strong Syrian governor Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, was not because they wanted to be the Khalifa. They didn't contest the position. They later were opposition to him. It started out by them demanding from him to bring the killers of Uthman to justice. They figured out in their minds that a certain process had to take place. Ali radiallahu anhu, who finds himself in the situation, figures out that he needs to deal with the situation in a different way. And this is a matter of what? This is a matter of ijtihad. It is a matter where you can exercise your personal opinion to figure out how to come out of the difficulty. They were disagreeing with regard to what was being done. Here, I want to remind you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, radiyallahu anhum wa radu an. Their iman and their position and their faith and their commitment to deen and everything else, it was already clearly proven. We are not standing here in judgment of anyone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them, and they are pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are not standing here in judgment of any human being. But at the end of the day, we are human beings. And we are prone to what? We are prone to be and act like human beings. We have opinions. Sometimes we want to voice them. Sometimes we are strong about our opinions. Sometimes we shout because we want to be heard. Sometimes we protest if we feel that we are not heard. This is the human condition. So the opposition was not to claim the Khilafah, though the conflict that resulted later on between Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah resulted in a schism, in a parting of ways, and it also resulted in Muawiyah radiallahu anh being appointed as a khalif during the Khilafah of Ali. Okay, at this point now, now your head is full, isn't it? Yalla, let's look for water. Wow. Sheikh, you must get water for everyone next week, inshallah. Okay. I wanted to. I've been speaking for almost an hour. Okay, we'll skip that, inshallah. Let's just go here. Let's talk about the beginning of the period of the contestation of the Khilafah. So now we're in a different period now. Ali radiallahu anh is the legitimate Khalifa. Things happened. There was differences of opinion with regard to how to deal with the situation of Uthman's killers. It resulted in Talha and Zubair forming a resistance group. And then finally it resulted in a battle which took place in Kufa, because the Kufites were supporting them as well. Ali radiallahu anh marched. He was on his way to Syria to go tell Muawiyah, why are you not accepting the Khilafah? Why are you resisting? I appointed another governor. You were there for 20 years. I've chosen someone else. He was on his way with his forces to Syria. He first dealt with an uprising. 10,000 Muslims were killed in the battle. Then he marched on to Syria. Muawiyah heard that he was coming. He mustered his forces and they marched out and they met at a place called Siffin. And fighting ensued and many people died. There's something technical that happened here. I don't want to talk too much on the technicalities. I'm trying to give you an overview. But Ali radiallahu anh, he was deserted, basically, on the battlefield. There was a group of that was with him that deserted him. They later came to be known as the Khawarij, the group that broke away. As a result of this, Ali radiallahu anh was somehow almost hamstrung into a arbitration. Now this situation of arbitration is not a necessarily, you and I would think, a bad situation, isn't it? We're going to appoint an arbitrator from our side and appoint an arbitrator from your side. And this arbitrator would be given 6 months, this process would be given 6 months, and then they would come up with a solution. And their solution would be according to the Book of Allah, as they claim. Okay. What happens there is that there is an arbitration process that somehow results in Muawiyah being appointed as the Khalifa. Right. Details, go find out. I can't give you everything, isn't it? Must leave some research for you. It results in Muawiyah radiallahu anh being appointed as a Khalifa. Ali doesn't accept this outcome. Already it was a diplomatic victory for Muawiyah to go into an arbitration process, isn't it? It was already a diplomatic victory. And then because there was an arbitration process and because now it seems almost like that is a legitimate claim to Khilafah, he accepts that he is the new Khalif. Ali doesn't accept him as the new Khalif. And now the Ummah that was firstly only divided in opinion now becomes divided geographically. The Ummah is now split into two geographically as well. with Ali radiallahu anhu being the Khalifa of a particular region, and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu being the Khalifa of other regions. And then to just add more fireworks, the Khawarij came out and they said, we don't want Ali and we don't want Muawiyah. So they set out to want to kill Muawiyah and Ali radiallahu anhu, and they set out with a reign of terror on anyone who is a supporter of Ali. And the Khawarij kills, I don't know how many Muslims in their reign of terror, just because they support the Khilafah of Ali radiallahu anhu. Eventually, there's skirmishes between the two. Muawiyah is now, there's incursions into territories. Muawiyah, Ali radiallahu anhu, there's incursions into territories. And this is sad. And when Sheikh told me to give this topic, this was part of the reason why you hesitate. Because you don't want to be the bearer of sad news, isn't it? Of the sad history. Inshallah, after this, the good part of the history is going to come. A lot of good happened in between here, by the way. I'm just talking about the Khilafah now, because I want you to have an understanding of Khilafah. It wasn't all doom and gloom. We had our best ages. The best things happened. Knowledge was flourishing. Libraries, science, maths. Things were happening. It wasn't all politics. But we are talking Khilafah here. We are talking rule. We are not talking education. We are not talking hadith. We are not talking what happened to Quran. We are not talking all of that. We are talking leadership and power. Khilafah. That's what we are talking. Eventually, Medina is taken. Medina is taken. After Medina is taken, the army marches on to Mecca. Mecca is taken. The next year, Ali radiallahu anhu is assassinated by one of the Khawarij. They also try to assassinate Muawiyah. Muawiyah escapes assassination. And Amr bin As, who was the governor of Egypt, they tried to assassinate him. It was supposed to be a triple assassination. The Khawarij wanted to just take everyone out. Sound familiar? Yeah, anyway. Yeah, there's a group that want to take everyone out now. But let's not go there. All right. And they didn't kill Muawiyah and they didn't kill Amr bin As. Unfortunately, Ali radiallahu anhu was killed and was assassinated by the Khawarij. At that point in time now Muawiyah is the Khalifa. Does this mean now that all the allegiances is going to go away? Ali's allegiances? No, the Ummah must split. So it doesn't matter if one person now comes and he says, I alone am the Khalif, that suddenly people now are going to all decide. That's not the nature of human beings. I wish it was the nature of human beings that we could just say, Alhamdulillah, we leave it to Allah now to sort it out in Qiyamah, but we're going to hug one another and be brothers. No. It's not the human condition. Maybe inshallah Allah will grant it to us one day. Maybe Allah will grant it to us one day where we can be so magnanimous that we will say, you know what? I don't care, man. It's about unity. The Prophet understood that. And his Khulafa understood it. And if we hope to be an Ummah again that has any type of clout, then we need to understand it. Hassan ibn Ali. Hassan ibn Ali becomes the next Khalifa. Muawiyah is still there. But we got this parallel thing going, isn't it? We got this parallel thing going. Now you don't have any more consensus. If the Ummah is in two, whoever's going to declare the next person a Khalifa doesn't have the consensus of the Ummah. Can you see what happens now? There's no more consensus. So now no one is going to consider the next Khalif legitimate anymore. And everyone is going to consider the opposing Khalifa illegitimate, and he's going to revolt against him. And in short, this is what had happened. I'm going to stop at this point. I've got some more things to say, but I'm going to stop at this point and give you a short summary. And then I'm going to open up for questions. Muawiyah had also died. There's still more tragic things that happened. The reason why you must think, why is this man making us so depressed tonight? You know what I'm saying? He came here just to depress us with regard to the Ummah. No, that's not the intention. The intention is that this word Khalifa and Khilafa is being used as some type of a red herring type of, it's a solution to all our problems. The word Khalifa and the concept Khalifa. We hear people saying, if only there's a Khalifa, then all our problems will be solved. Hearing what you have just heard, knowing what you know now, is it Khilafa that solves the problem? Or is it people who understand what their responsibility is as the Khalifa? Do they solve the problem? Does a concept solve the problem? Or do people solve the problem? So people are selling the concept. They're selling a concept. My summary is that Khilafa is a succession tool. And this is open for discussion. I said this is not a lecture. I said this is a classroom, inshallah ta'ala. Khilafa is a succession tool for the transference of authority and leadership from one person to the next. That is what Khilafa is. The term Khilafa not only refers to transference of power, but also to transference of responsibility of what such power is supposed to achieve. You can be called a Khalif, but if you don't understand what that responsibility entails and what your Khilafa is supposed to achieve, then Khilafa means nothing, even though it exists. And it existed, the last remnants of it was dismantled in Spain, where they just said, "Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin," and then it was finished. It didn't mean anything at that point in time. The Prophet was the example of what Muslim leadership should aspire to achieve. He was the example. Point number three. I've got 9 points and I'm done. While this may be complex in its details, it can be summarized as a rule that establishes, or Khilafa can be complex in the details, but it can be summarized as a rule that establishes a citizenry that is united under Islam, that recognizes the afterlife as the final and everlasting abode, and this world as a means of attaining salvation through obedience and closeness to Allah. This is what a Khilafa should seek to achieve for its citizenry. Number four, Khilafa, as it took shape after the demise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was in part a product of the time. What do I mean when I say it was in part a product of the time? I've explained that in a little bit of detail when I told you how Arabia functioned prior to Islam, how the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam brought Islam and it was the galvanizing force, and how successorship was a natural consequence. Someone had to become a leader. There was no concept of democracy or different types of rule, whatever the case may be. There was Caesar and there was the other types of rule. There was the Muluks, but that wasn't the example that the Muslims were going to follow. Number five, the method of establishing a Khalifa was modified according to the demands of the time. It wasn't static. Every Khalifa that was appointed under different circumstances. And because of the different circumstances, the type of appointment also changed. When Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, before he died, he made sure that everyone understood that his son, Yazid, was going to be the next Khalifa. And he went and canvassed and he made sure that everyone would pay allegiance to Yazid, his son. He made sure of this. And this was the start of the Umayyad dynasty. You heard this word before, Umayyad dynasty. It was a Khalifa, but it was a dynasty. What do I mean by that? I mean, it was a Khalifa in that they had to rule according to what they know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had taught. That they knew that and they understood that responsibility, but it was a dynasty in that power was kept in the family. As a result of this, there was even more conflict. There was the Abbasid conflict. So it was being modified all the time. People also have this idea that there is just one model. They have this idea that this is how you institute the Khilafah. Like there's a dummy's guide to instituting a Khalifa. If this was the complex society in the time of the companions and the Tabi'een and the Adba'u Tabi'een, can you imagine the complexities of today's society? Or aren't we a complex society? We're not complex. We all get along, isn't it? We all get along, yes. We have nothing that disunites us. We agree on everything in Cape Town. We wish. We wish. We make dua, inshallah ta'ala. One day maybe. I don't know if we're going to live long enough to see that day. I've been making dua for the last 20 years just to have Eid on one day. You know? Anyway. Number 6. Public opinion started to play a big role. Public opinion started to play a big role in the balance of power, even under a Khilafah. This is important. People think that public opinion didn't play a role. Public opinion after the demise of Uthman radiallahu an, public opinion played a role all the time. They were trying to manage public opinion. They were trying to sway public opinion. There was a lot to do because they realized that there was power and strength in public opinion. People tend to believe in this day and age that no, public opinion never featured. Number 7, it becomes apparent that how leadership is established, it becomes apparent, I claim, I might not be right, but my claim is, it becomes apparent that how leadership is established is not important. As how it is important for the reasons for leadership being established. I'll repeat that. How leadership is established is not as important as the reasons for leadership being established. How you put the leader there is not as important as the reasons for the leader being there and the job he's supposed to do. The job he's supposed to do is much more. Him having an understanding of what he's supposed to deliver on is much more important on how he gets there. But it is also important. Number 8. Once the reasons for leadership becomes confused, then the stage is set for corruption. When people want to assume power for the sake of power, where people want to assume power so that they can wield the decision-making process, so that they can have the decision-making process in their hands. If it is for this reason, then the stage is set for corruption. This wasn't the sunnah of the Khulafa al-Rashidin. Wasn't their sunnah. They didn't want, none of them wanted. They were all, I said this previously, they were all reluctant recipients to the position. Because they understood what it entailed. It didn't mean richness. It didn't mean kingdom and dominion. It meant responsibility. It meant work. It meant sleepless nights. It meant having to live with a notion that people might want to kill you because they are ignorant of what you are trying to achieve. Later on, it became about power. Number nine, and we will end of here. This means that corruption can even thrive under a khilafah form of rule. What did I say? Corruption can even thrive under a khilafah form of rule. Right. So, the future of khilafah. Sheikh started with a hadith. Can you just repeat that word that you uttered of the hadith? Yes? Then it will end off. That is the hadith Sheikh recited. Then towards the end, it will end according to khilafah, according to the minhaj, according to the manhaj or the way of prophethood. This is how it will end. This is what the hadith says. I will end of the inshallah. I think maybe I should give an opinion on that. So does this mean that what does this hadith mean? The hadith can be interpreted. It lends itself to interpretation. It means basically that there will be leadership for the ummah that will be leadership according to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's what it means. How the leadership, how it comes into being, what the leadership will be called in Arabic, it might be called khilafah, but it might be via a process that we know, that we're familiar with, or even that we are not familiar with. But we believe in the Prophet of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So at this juncture, I left out a couple of things in between. If there is questions, I really want to thank you very much for your patience. It wasn't an easy talk to sit through. It is one of the longest talks I've ever given. I don't recall ever speaking so long. So shukran for your patience and shukran for your attentiveness. Jazakumullahu khair wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Shukran.
We say shukran to Mawlana Zakaria, and Allah Ta'ala reward him. And we know it has been a very challenging topic. But I conclude with a statement that one of our teachers made, where he said, establish an Islamic state within yourself by purifying your soul. And may Allah Ta'ala grant us to look within ourselves introspectively and change ourselves. And once the condition within ourselves has changed, Allah Ta'ala will change the condition of the ummah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamu ala al-mursaleen. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.